Good evening and welcome, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us here in the Canbar Forum tonight for a very special program, a conversation between Lia Halloran and Maria Popova. My name is Sam. I'm one of the program developers that is responsible for producing these After Dark events. We're open every Thursday night here at Pier 15. Thank you. For how many of you is this your first time visiting us at Pier 15 for After Dark? Wow, welcome. So glad that you found us. It really is a treat to get to gather in community here at this museum that is so beloved by staff and visitors alike. This program tonight is going to be a really special treat. We're linking it to the black box installation that we have here in Gallery 1 that Lia Halloran did of a piece called Double Horizon. You'll hear about that more briefly. But along with the support of our incredible AV team, both in the booth and on these cameras here, we are also live streaming this event right now. So hello, world. Thanks for visiting us, and we hope you enjoy the program as well. When you work in a museum that asks people to take a closer look at the world around them, we value the opportunity to really think deeply about where we are and how we got here. Over the last 2 years, we've developed a land acknowledgement with Ramatush Ohlone Partners. We have it sitting in our gallery and published on our website, but what's meaningful for me when we get together is that we can take time to recognize the place that we're on the edge of the bay, the land, water, just over the water right now, and territory that's been occupied for tens of thousands of years by the Ramatush Ohlone. And for ourselves at the Exploratorium to recognize that we're guests on this land and that all the stewardship and caretaking that has happened here before, it's on us to continue that kindness and dedication to relationship. So it's a very well tied to the piece that we're gonna be talking about tonight. Lia's piece, Double Horizon, really does ask you to look at the landscape and consider it quite differently as well. My colleague, Kirsten Bach, who is the interim arts director, will be introducing the program briefly, but I'll just continue with a couple housekeeping notes. First and foremost, I know I need this reminder as we get back into the physical world, please turn off the sound of any devices that you have in your pocket. We don't want to disturb the flow of the conversation. And if you need to use the restroom, the closest one are going to be outside these doors. You can go out to our lobby and then find your way back in afterwards. As well, the format of the talk will be Lia and Maria here on these lovely chairs, just in conversation for about 45 minutes or so. Then we're gonna give the chance to take a few questions from the audiences. So stand by with those questions if you have something burning. And finally, I just wanna say thanks again so much for being here. The After Dark, we have a membership as well that would grant you access to all After Darks for an entire year. So if you wanted to consider that, you can actually apply the cost of tonight's ticket to that membership. So we do hope to see you in the future and continue to support programs like this. And I would now thrilled to introduce my wonderful colleague, Interim Arts Director, Kirsten Bach.
Thank you, Sam. As Sam mentioned, my name is Kirsten Bach. I'm the Interim Arts Director here. I did write up a few notes, so I didn't forget all the great details about our two speakers tonight. Thank you for joining us in this conversation between the two incredible thinkers that it is my true privilege to introduce. Some of our visitors here may not be aware that art plays a very important role at the Exploratorium in all that we do, really. As a learning institution, the arts here can provide yet another entry point to learning. Art can be a language, an investigation, a way of knowing, leading to understanding. The artworks that we show here, interwoven with the hands-on science exhibits on our floor, often reveal art as an art practice as a way of knowing. When looking at the biographies of the work of tonight's speakers, Lia Halloran and Maria Popova, I was struck how both of them in many ways are difficult to define. Are they teachers or learners? Artists or scientists, historians or creators? Because of the interdisciplinary nature of their bodies of work, they, much like the institution that we call the Exploratorium, defy definition. What I know is that their bios are long, and there is much to say about each of their contributions. But in the interest of time and your attention, I will keep my introductions brief. I'll start with Lia Halloran, whose artwork, Double Horizon, we are currently featuring in our Black Box Gallery. Double Horizon is on view at the Exploratorium through Sunday, August 7th, and I hope that all of you joining us in person will get a chance to see it tonight. And if you're joining online, please do come visit if you can. Double Horizon is a video installation that envelops the viewer in video footage of the Los Angeles Basin, shot from cameras mounted to a plane piloted by Lia as she was learning to fly. While we're showing a video artwork by Lia, Lia is an artist who creates work in many media, including painting and photography. She draws inspiration and content from science, nature, history, and identity. She's participated in a wide range of interdisciplinary collaborations with scientists and architects, including an upcoming book with Nobel laureate Kip Thorne about the warped side of the universe. After discovering Lia's work, we are absolutely delighted to learn that she developed her deep love of science at her first high school job, here as an explainer at the Exploratorium. She performed cow eye dissections and laser demonstrations for our public. Lia is represented by Luis de Jesus, Los Angeles, and is an associate professor at Chapman University, teaching courses that explore the intersection of art and science. Welcome back to the Exploratorium, Lia. We hope that you always feel this place is a home for you. We're also thrilled to welcome here tonight Maria Popova. Maria thinks and writes about science and art, poetry and philosophy, children's books, and our search for meaning. She is the creator of The Marginalian, a blog born in 2006 under the name Brain Pickings. The Marginalian is included in the Library of Congress Permanent Digital Archive of Culturally Available Materials. Maria is the author of a book entitled Figuring, which explores the search for truth and meaning by reflecting on the lives of remarkable artists, writers, and scientists. She's also the author of the acclaimed picture book for children of all ages entitled The Snail with the Right Heart. She's the maker of Universe in Verse, a wonderful live event series that she describes as a charitable celebration of the wonder of reality through stories of science winged with poetry. Back to what I said about Lia and Maria being so many things and defying definition. What I do know about Lia and Maria is that the work they produce invites wonder, investigation, reflection, and ultimately, perhaps, orientation. Much like the artwork Double Horizon, where you can find a horizon line to orient yourself in the landscape before you, it is just as easily dissolved and then lost, only for you to find it again. Please join us for this conversation, where I believe we'll be invited to wander along a path of thoughts and ideas navigated by Lia and Maria, and I, for one, hope to get lost a little bit.
Good evening. What a joy to be here in this laboratory for connection and wonder. Walking through the space, it is my first time at the Exploratorium, and walking through the space and experiencing Double Horizon, I just had this thought last night at my friend's house. We were looking at these flowers, these incredible angel's trumpets that open up at night and only at night emit this fragrance to attract bats. And I took a picture to send to somebody and had this thought of how we haven't figured out how to digitize any but two of our senses. And you can transmit smell. You can transmit the silky texture of these blossoms. And then I thought about how even the five senses, I mean, Plato and Aristotle got it pretty limited, because now we know we have interoception, the feeling of the internal process of our body, and proprioception, or motion in space. And experiencing Double Horizon, somehow you have managed to capture these extrasensory bodily senses with the limitations of digital media, and that's extraordinary. From the music that puts you in this kind of emotive embodied state to the enveloping and even the editing of the horizons, you're really put back into your own body. And I just have been thinking about how much you use your body in your body of work in all different projects, not just Double Horizon, but from your time as one of the first women skateboarders, gay women skateboarders in LA, and you making art with that. The cyanotype project that's actually called Your Body as a Space That Sees. And how perfect that we're here at the Exploratorium, where so much is about using the body to interact with the universe, essentially, beyond the skin. I just wonder how you ended up using the body as part of the creative process in such a concrete way.
Well, I think as when we think of art, we think of our sense of sight, that you're looking at something. But I have always been, my favorite pieces are pieces that create a sense of awe or wonder, and that really envelop what it means to have an experience, a transformative experience. And so I think in all of my work, I try to challenge the viewer's nature of what perception is, mm-hmm. so that you kind of, like in Kirsten's introduction about this, this piece is called Double Horizon, so it's suggesting something that we know and understand and use to locate ourselves, which is a horizon, but that mm-hmm. your understanding of your body could be transformed by a dislocation or kind of moving that perception around. So I think the body is a really important part of what I do as a maker of these projects, but also I'm also then become at some point the viewer of these objects and mm-hmm. Or you know the piece itself. Like I made this piece I guess 3 years ago now. This is the fourth location of it being shown, and I still find joy of looking at it because I become not the maker but the viewer.
How is it different? The experience of flying and taking the footage versus then watching it reversed on you as you both the viewer and the viewed.
Well, it's interesting because the I actually kind of in the piece in collecting the footage, it was collected over a period of 2 years, and I would attach the cameras to the external parts of the plane, and then I just had like a little remote, and when I would take off, I would start the camera. And so I wasn't really aiming at something. It was like collecting. It's almost like going on a walk, really. You
it's
just
like
kind of don't know what you're
landscape.
Going to. Yeah, you don't know what you're going to intercept. So there's different points where, one of my favorite parts of the film is when the plane pulls off and you see the tail of the plane in that shadow. Well, if I could have calculated the angle of the sun and the angle of the runway, I maybe could have come up with that and known what time to take off. But that was, just like the passing of another plane mm-hmm. off the side of my wing. I just happened to have turned the camera that day. And then there was other times where I flew, like I was landing in tandem with a big jet at Burbank, and I was like, this is gonna be the most incredible footage. And of course that day the camera was like turned the other way. So I missed it. So there's a lot of amazing things that happened.
But that's another interesting common denominator, how much you have such a clear vision of the art you're making, but you invite this room for total unpredictability with the physical world, even with your cyanotype work. I mean, so much of it is waiting for the right season, for the sun to be out for a particular amount of hours so you can lay down the chemicals, and so much can go wrong, even with the most precise vision, and yet those errors become folded into the art, folded into the story, and recomposed into this larger story of the art that factors in the environment and the landscape and the elements that are actually part of the art and not a hindrance to the art.
I love that part about there's like a humbling part where there's certain things that are just out of your control. Like when I first started making cyanotypes, I was like, I'm gonna use the sun. The sun's out all the time, right? We know when it comes.
She lives in LA, by the way.
It's out all the
giveaway.
Time. Giveaway. And it's not. It's like I learned so much over the past 6 years because the angle of the sun changes. You're actually like using astronomy to make these prints because the sun has to be directly overhead, which means you can print only from like June to end of September. And even just moving across the day, the sun's path, it changes the exposure time drastically. So I love that even through making the process, those pieces are about astronomy and stars. It's made by the sun, but also I learned so much about something that I just completely took for granted. And in a way, it was like humbled by it, but also just the process of it is built into the piece itself. And that's, I think, is so important in all of my work, that the media is like determined by the concept. So, you know, when I was thinking about, we really wanted to make a piece about landscape and time, and that I was like, well, it's gotta be a video piece, you know, but I had never made a video piece before making this work.
Time is another major one of your raw materials, really. Yeah. I would say that's the baseline of all the different types. I mean, you work in so many different styles. Cyanotype is so different from video. It's so different from the night, what is it called?
Darkscape.
The
series of photographs. Yeah.
Photographs of just sort of light moving through in slow motion, long exposure, I guess. Mm-hmm. And it's all about capturing time, which is another dimension that we have such a creaturely sense of, but we aren't very good at conveying from one consciousness to another. My experience of time is so different from yours, and yet something about your art is very much about inviting this communal dialogue between time. And then your paintings of star trails, say a little bit more about that, because I actually think that relates to Double Horizon in flipping the relationship between the seen and the seer.
Yeah, the nature of time, I think, is interesting because we all have some sort of perception of it, but then it's very easily misperceived. And I love that the looking at something, you could have that confusion of time. So you referred to the series of Dark Skate. Those are long exposure photographs where I'm skateboarding in the dark with a light attached. And light attached to my body. So I love that it's like similar to Double Horizon.
Again,
I'm the performer, it's back to the body. But that there's this misperception that the exposure times are 45 minutes. So when you look at them, you think, oh, they're taken in the daytime. They're taken they're taken almost like you can't see your hand in front of your face. Mm-hmm. And it's very, very hard for a viewer to kind of understand that this nature of the lens being open is what's like, you know, creating this misunderstanding of viewing. And Maria is referring to a new series of paintings where I'm using a kind of modality of how we think about, you know, you look at an image of star trails. It's really almost like a very baseline experiment where you can leave a camera open and it's really the earth turning in space. So again, a kind of misunderstanding of like time and space and movement. And I just love kind of playing with that sense of perception.
And also to your point about how much of astronomy we take for granted. I mean, when you say 45 minute exposures, just reminding me of how that's exactly how long Edwin Hubble used when in October 1923 he took that historic photograph of Andromeda and figured out, thanks to our girl Henrietta Swan-Leavitt, her data, one of the Harvard computers, the women observing at the Harvard Observatory, who basically figured out how to calculate the distance of stars for the first time. And Hubble then made this 45 minute exposure of Andromeda that rendered one of the tiny flecks in there visible and not what was previously thought to be a nova. And that's how we have the yardstick of the universe, knowing how far things are. But the notion of a long exposure as a kind of deconfusion of our intuitive concepts of time and space, because right, they're so interrelated. When you're recording time, you're also recording space as Earth is moving. And Double Horizon has also the sense of we're moving in time and in space at the same time, making me think of how the early balloonists, the aeronauts, were the first people who really lifted off of Earth's surface and saw the landscape as a cohesive whole. And suddenly, I mean, I would say that's really the dawn of any kind of environmental and ecological awareness, when they came out and saw the world as this organism, national borders as this human artifice, and all of a sudden we had this view from above of horizons that had never before been seen, and now here we are in flying through this landscape that interpolates between extreme city, LA city skyscrapers, to extreme nature with the ocean and the rock, and the way that you've edited it with the two horizons, it looks like a fault line, a geologic fault line with the ocean in between and the city and civilization and landscape in dialogue. What was your thinking in terms of the relationship between humanity and landscape in that sort of bird's eye view?
Well, I was my early school days, I was a painter. I have an MFA in painting. And so you can't get away from the discussion about what landscape is. And I always thought it was rather boring or provincial, and yet it was something that I continually engage in. We all do. And was there a way for me to reimagine what landscape is, to that could be somewhat surprising by exploring a landscape that was very familiar? So one of the things that that I found to be most exciting about making this piece is that the airport that I flew out of is very close to my house. And so I would often actually be flying over my house, flying over the freeways that I would, go around the area, go down to teach, and they would, as you describe by these balloonists, they would become completely new. I would see things even though I'm like traversing these spaces for, over a decade, the same spaces, I would be re-excited about something that I would never have perceived just through that shift of scale and mm-hmm. perception. And so that I feel like was a way to even rethink about what landscape could be. And then by literally turning the landscape on its head, to again kind of think about what horizon is of locating oneself. I hope that the viewer also maybe thinks about what does it mean to have a female pilot, the same way that the Darkskate series is, like, you don't usually think of women and queer women as skateboarders, that you sort of are like, I think I know what this is, but the longer that you sit there, the more you actually gets pushed back on you, like, oh, this is a land, this is like, I've been in a plane, this is a horizon, and then it kind of continues to fragment in like a kaleidoscopic way.
Mm. I mean, this is, I have to ask now about your time at the Exploratorium, because I know that planted a seed for all of these questions in little teenage you with your Han Solo haircut there.
Maria knows that when I was 6 years old, I told my mom that I wanted to have my hair cut like Han Solo. And they said yes. And I've looked like this ever since. So when I was 15, I asked that I could have my 15th birthday party at the Exploratorium. And we came, and we were doing a tour of the tactile dome, where you can go through these like passages where it's like incomplete darkness, and heightens what your sense, your other senses are. And I think being at the Exploratorium, it is like, it's such a place of wonder. So to have that worked here my very first job doing cow eye dissections and laser demonstrations as the explainers group, and then I was hired in the machine shop, and I learned how to build almost anything. It was 16 years old and using a sandblaster and an end mill and a lathe, and I had a 1967 bug, and we would drive it into the wood machine shop and fiddle with it. That was such a talk about an experience, like a physical embodied experience of what science could be, is that I felt like science was tangible. It was like exciting and something not to be put on a platform and be scared of in some way. And so I think that set the foundation for my studio practice of just total curiosity, not scared of learning different mediums and medias, and it really, I think, influenced my studio practice almost more than my time in undergrad and grad school.
Mm. It's so interesting. I think part of what has always drawn me to your work is that there's this, I also very much feel that treating science or art or any way of any mode of understanding as a separate discipline, right, actually limits so much. And in your work, there's this, it's almost like art and science is part of the art. Art is not something to prettify or explainify the science, but there's this kind of mycelial web beneath it all that all the elements arise from in a very natural way. And I can't help but think that that's only possible when you've been so immersed with your body, with your body forming as a human being in the world, learning how to be a person in the world, immersed in these dual worlds, and then sort of not, I think that's our natural way of being and parsing reality through these analytical expressionist modes, and we unlearn when we get put into the school of disciplines.
Right.
But when you kind of bypass that through the back door of just making, it's so easy to then maintain that as part of, instead of having to relearn it in a way, to reintegrate what's naturally cohesive.
Right, I mean, even in like the way that MFA programs are set up, like I have an MFA in painting, and I felt like what a like wasted possibility to interact with the sculpture faculty and the photo faculty. And so even conceptually, when I was going through school, it really seemed that everyone was highlighting these like sense of silos. And I just, again, kind of going back to like, what is the art that makes me excited? What are the things that, you know, that when I walk into my studio that I'm really excited to engage in? And it's these things that are not, that are just like outside of where they should be. You know, that there's they can create a sense of surprise, maybe in the materiality, or a sense of awe in the concept. And those were always the things that I felt like most thrilled by and then would pursue. I mean, I've done a lot of very bizarre things that did not turn out very well. You know, so I think there's another part of like, if you can become a painter and become a great painter, you could just continue making that one painting, which many artists do in other ways for, you know, a career.
But I would say that's catering, that's not creating, that's catering to the expectation. Yeah. But okay, so now you teach, and now you teach in the way that you experience art and you embody art. Say something about, first of all, what's been the most surprising thing about teaching? And also, I mean, you take your students to observatories, your art students. You assign them Rebecca Solnit's Field Guide to Getting Lost. You refuse to buy into the segregation of disciplines and really ways of thinking.
I mean, I always say that, like, I want to teach the class that would have like changed my life when I was 19 years old. And so when I think about what's exciting to me, then yeah, maybe it's the new images on the web telescope, but it's also Beyonce's new album, and it's this, and it's that, and it's like all over the place. And like, why can't we talk about the things that really excite us about merging culture? So, you know, I am a professor at Chapman University, and I'm, again, technically head of the painting department there, but I try, you know, I continue to develop these classes that are completely interdisciplinary. So I take my students to NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, and there they work with designers who are, you know, building things that are going places that no one's gone before. And that's very similar conceptually in a foundation level of making a sculpture that has never existed before. You know, I mean, I think that there's definitely a spot where they completely diverge, but that underlying conversation is so exciting to see students have. And I love including my students on as many projects in my studio that I can, any like, you know, installations or projects, because I think that it's a way to continue to have a dialogue about these ideas that are not fleshed out. It takes me a long time to come up with, you know, honing in on the project. So even like Double Horizon, I was collecting imagery I was just shooting every flight that I would take for the first 2 years. And I wasn't really, I knew there was something there. I didn't know what it was. But I think that, you know, engaging students and people who are really excited about learning something that is like just gonna change the way they think of things. And especially art students, for them to go to JPL for the first time and they think, oh my gosh, I'm so lucky we're here. And then by the end of the class, they're like, I have something creative to say about problem solving. You know, not that they're going to go work at NASA, maybe they will, but I don't know, but the point is that they then understand that science is theirs and engineering is theirs. And, you know, I think that's one thing that that I find troubling is that at certain point, like, we can all agree that kids are super curious and they're really curious about the natural world, and then all of a sudden at a certain point it's called science and physics, and that closes a door. And so I hope that in my teaching and in my projects that it's like, I want my work to be an open invitation to everyone, you know, that you could have a five-year-old to come and watch this video and be equally thrilled as someone who, you know, is in the art world.
Well, it's making me think of the extraordinarily kind and generous words that Kirsten said in the introduction about whether it's teaching or learning, the unclassifiable nature, you know, that I think as an artist of any kind, whether you're a writer, whether you're a painter, whether you're a maker of unclassifiable stuff, you have to be both student and learner at the same time if you're growing at all, which includes making things that don't work out.
Yes.
It includes making them with people who don't know what they're doing.
Right.
But I think the greatest gift to young people in general, whether they're formal students or whether you're people who engage with your work informally, is precisely this power of the unexampled, modeling something that hasn't existed before with the assurance that that's actually not just okay, but welcome, and how we advance our way of thinking and our way of doing.
Yeah, I think, like, for people who have taught, you often say to young students, like, take risks. And I don't think you can really say that unless you're kind of doing it yourself and you understand that level of, like, whether it's fear or whether it's shame or embarrassment. And I love having a sense of embarrassment in my work, you know, like, that to me is like, I know that I'm in the right direction, you know, because that I feel like when I'm in a place where I understand what's happening and I know how something is going to turn out, then that's very, like, dangerous, because it just will be, you know, something that maybe somebody else could have thought of.
Few things are more exciting than that moment when you find out you've been wrong about something. And I mean, it's easy to say, but actually when we think about it, peeling past the shame or embarrassment or humiliation, underneath that there's this real thrill every time you realize your worldview has been somehow limited or miscalibrated, this sense of, oh, there's more to see, there's more to know, which is another way of saying I'm not dead. I mean, all art is really a hedge against our own mortality, right?
Yeah.
Because the moment we're certain,
yeah,
that's that we're done.
Yeah. I mean, this is so much of what you do in your own research and interest and writing. I mean, the way that you kind of are going head on and finding connections in places that, you know, that most people could kind of not understand, this giant matrix. I feel like it's very similar, where you could kind of get lost in the unknown, and you always tend to weave it back.
Well, it's interesting. I think actually that's how the mind works. Left to its own devices without structure, that's how the mind works, this associative firing, right? And anything I make that the outside world sees is something that's just the record of the process I've undergone for myself of learning this and getting so enchanted and thrilled and following this footnote and this trail down to this other thing. And then
literally following the trail in Maria's case. We use that in...
this is an uncanny situation. Every time I'm on the phone with Lia, strange things happen around me that involve birds of prey or horses that recognize my voice. This is not my normal life, but Lia's convinced that she is.
2 months ago, Maria picked up the phone and we talked for 2 minutes, and then she says, hang on, I know that horse.
No, the horse knew me. That was the weird thing. Random horse. Stranger's horse in the forest. So that's art and life right here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm thinking again about Double Horizon, and to me, one of the most powerful things actually in terms of taking it beyond just digital, sort of digital experiences, the music. How it really, because one of the things that we can't replicate with digital technology is interoception, so the internal feelings of the body as you're lifting off in an airplane against gravity, at the thrill, the feeling of awe that now psychologists study in your chest and all these kind of neurotransmitters firing, blood vessels opening up. This is not something we can capture with a recording, but music has this extraordinary power above, I would say, all the arts. It's the most embodied of all the arts. What was your process like, first of all, working with the incredible Alison Newman? The soundtrack of Double Horizon is its own just masterpiece on top of the masterpiece. And I really do think that's what makes it feel like an embodied experience in a way that just watching it in video wouldn't take you to that extrasensory level. What was that like?
Thank you so much for asking about that, because that part of it was kind of what we're talking about, is like an opportunity to learn something new. Is this is like the first time I'd made a video, but it also was the first time to collaborate with a composer. So when I invited Ali to collaborate with me on this, I said, I want to make a piece about fracturing time. So I want to be able to watch it, but I also want you to close your eyes and be able to feel like time is fracturing. Mm-hmm. And like loosely, you know, in Double Horizon, you take off in one space and then there's kind of this separation, and I land in three different spaces. And the process of doing this was, you know, Ali has done several incredible documentary full-length films. She did the Yayo Kusama film, Infinity, and her process is, once the film is done and locked, that's when the composer comes in. In this case, she started from the very beginning, and we had a standing date every Friday, mm-hmm. where she would come in, we would show what we were editing, and then she would, it was almost like a call and response. She would then edit for the next, she would have 2 days, and then by Monday we'd get it back, and then we would edit back to what the sound was. And so it was really interesting because the sound actually moved some of the visuals around, and then the visuals then moved the sound. But so what was so important to me about the sound is that it felt exactly like you said, just totally encompassing that. In and of itself, it would sort of tell this loose narrative of a journey and the tension that you might get while watching it, whether that's excitement or fear of flying or, you know, elation or joy, whatever that is, that the sound does that as much as the visuals do.
It's making me think of the philosopher Suzanne Langer, who a long time ago, in the 70s or earlier, defined music as a laboratory for feeling in time. And that's exactly nice. What this feels like, this immersive experience of your experience with time, but this level of feeling that's in constant dialogue with it and magnifying it and modulating it. And do you think music is going to, I mean, I can't imagine having that experience with a composer and going back. Like, I would imagine music will be somehow in your future. What do you think about next?
Well, I am making on each project is an opportunity to learn something new, and I don't know what I'll be, you know, making in 5 years, and that to me is super exciting.
How do you move from one project to the next? I imagine it's some kind of little seed that was planted in the previous project, and how do you follow these trails? How do you know which one is kind of the fertile direction?
I think the key to that is that I have several projects going on at once, because that like germination period of really discovering like what to invest in, like so much of my studio I think looks like it really looks like an experimental laboratory. And I've walked into my studio at times and I'm like, it looks like there's four people who are in here, but there's just me. And I think that there's, like I said, there's a lot of projects that I start and I know that there's something there and I've maybe never figured it out. And there's other, you know, like Darkscape, when I first started making that series, like I had gone out to lunch with a friend and she had said, oh, what are you doing later? And I said, as I was saying the sentence, it came out of my mouth, I said, I'm gonna break into the skate park and put a bike light on my wrist. And I was like, just felt like so shameful, like saying that out loud to her. It's like, she's not gonna respect me after this. And I don't know like who in the art world would take me seriously after this. And then this, you know, this series, the images and the work that came out of that was exactly the distillation of trying to describe, you know, the physics of moving in the body and, you know, in the nighttime, and also kind of replicating my growing up in San Francisco as a female skateboarder in the 90s. And so it actually ended up being multi-layered, but I needed to, make these sort of like what I felt was really embarrassing work. At the same time, I was like making, you know, a painting series about something else. But I continue to work on multiple projects at one time. But there's these overarching themes, like you addressed, that I would say it's time and perception that really overarch my entire studio practice. So in a way, the dialogue continues in many, you know, in many different ways.
And it's interesting that you're turning to LIGO now and gravitational waves, which is kind of as large scale as time can get.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking about colossal events taking place billions of light years away at these just extraordinary rates that we hear the tiny ripples that reach us across time and space. And how, I mean, from the miniature of the skate park to this, you know, maximum dimension, but it, but the same component unifying this question of what is all this?
Yes. And the fact that LIGO is like, what is all this? Now it's a wave. It's something, you know, that, that you can listen to, or it's detected in waveform versus, you know, visual astronomy. I love that it's like changing our understanding of what this is, but in a totally different medium.
And it would be interesting to see how you recompose it into an embodied or something that engages once again the body, which I feel like is so central to everything that you do that you just can't get away from it. There's always some invitation back into the body, and this absolute abstraction with LIGO. I mean, it is such an abstract thing for us to even consider. People understand it only as either as data or as some kind of mental image, but it doesn't feel as intimate as a cyanotype printing of a human body laid out in the California sun, and yet it's made of the same material, both the art and the physicality of just matter, you know, time and space and matter. And it's so interesting, this invitation.
I think that that's such a perfect way to say it, is the intimacy of it. Because like when we think about when, you know, again, when you're young or why you're excited about something, it's because you had some sort of intimate experience of it. Mm-hmm. Were you excited to read a giant article about astronomy, or was it the moment that you looked through a telescope? And I think it's very profound. One of my favorite things to do is to take my students to Mount Wilson Observatory and watch them look through the telescope at Saturn. We know what Saturn looks like. There's a million incredible images of it. This is on the 60-inch telescope. It's not the most fancy largest telescope in any by any stretch, but just to see it, you have this experience that it's intimate, it's yours, and it then I think that's the moment that it transfers into the body. So I think in all of my work, there's a level of intimacy that's really, and most of the time I try to involve my body. Again, there's like this subtle sense of representation that's always there, or the work is about someone who's not represented. So many times it's about, you know, where are the women? Where are the queer people? Where are the, you know, the those who have, their stories haven't been told yet. And it's in those moments of those intimacies that I think that that then becomes like a profound transformational experience for the viewer.
And it's also a way of disabling the cerebral reservations or blockages that we might have about certain things by opening up this kind of feeling portal. I mean, I do this with the universe in verse, where we're using poetry as the Trojan horse to get people to feel so that they can think about real scientific questions like entropy or dark matter or whatever. And now you're working on a book of poems by the great Kip Thorne, who won the Nobel Prize for the detection of gravitational waves. Say a little bit about this. Just a little, give us a little teaser, because I'm personally, selfishly, most excited about this.
I mean, how can I not make a book, not make a piece about LIGO after working on this book with Kip for now 12 years? So Kip, you know, is such an incredible, wonderful human. And we started working on what was supposed to be an article for Playboy magazine. He had been invited to do an article for Playboy magazine. I think this was like, it's been...
The times are a-changing. A theoretical physicist is writing for
Well,
Playboy.
Actually, that's kind of an interesting story, because him and Stephen Hawking have this very famous bet.
Oh, the wager, yeah.
It's like something like, I can't even remember exactly. It's like, are there naked singularities in black holes? And they make this bet. They like put it on the wall at Caltech, and you know, it becomes a famous bet. And Playboy hears about it, and because of the nature of they then invited Kip to do this article. Long story short, the article is never published.
The times are not a changing footnote.
I was I was positive I was going to be the first person to put trans women in Playboy magazine without them knowing about it, because all of my paintings were all of like queer and trans women. But the article wasn't published, so I can't claim that.
But it's going in the book.
But it all will be in the book. And so we started this. It was really just, we love working together, and it started off as an article, and Kip was like, let's make 5 to 8 paintings, and that became 8 to 15 paintings. And now 12 years later, I've made 400 paintings, and it's a 220-page book, which is one long poem. Mm-hmm. And the poem is about, it's called The Warp Side of the Universe, and it's about black holes and wormholes, but tying back to this nature of like intimacy. Like, I think that only Kip Thorne could write a 220-page poem about black holes and, you know, gravitational waves. And then there's one space traveler in the book, and that's my wife, Felicia, which was through, not my idea, but through Kip's insistence. And again, to try to make this like very personal and something that just doesn't exist in the world. And so it's like an invitation of intimacy. It's like an invitation to the universe, but through a door of intimacy. Which I just love it, so it'll be.
Which is actually how it all began, because the first, way back, not your collaboration, but the first English use of space to mean outer space was in line 650 of book one of Paradise Lost. So if Milton lived now in the time of gravitational astronomy, he could have maybe given Kip a run for his money with the epic poem about the actual phenomenon.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably too long to work on a project. I'll be very excited that the book, we're about to kind of deliver it to our publisher, and it'll be out next year. And I'm just excited for it to, you know, kind of exist in the world as this other option to what, you know, what science could be.
And talk about the power of the unexampled. I mean, who would have thought? There's nothing to liken it to. It's an epic poem about hardcore science by a Nobel-winning scientist who's in dialogue with art that features all these incredible paintings by a queer woman, of queer women, that is really kind of all the pieces that you would never say are one, but yet they are one, and now they are an example that's unexampled. That's
well,
so
Kip
beautiful.
And I always said, like, this is the book that we would want to read, but we don't know if anyone else would.
That's
so at least we'll sell a third copy to Maria.
That's the only art you ever want to make, right? The art you want to see exist in the world, and anything else is just not worth making.
Yeah, and it's also just been an extraordinary collaboration, because it's been a challenge. Like, most of my work, as we've talked about with Double Horizon or even the Dark Skate series, is, you know, it's images of me skateboarding in the dark, but the foundation of that is actually long exposure astrophotography. And so to say like these are about astrophysics, or they're represented by astrophysics, or they're some sort of representation, it's not like I'm making a diagram of science, right? It's like that has influenced me. It's the way that I think of nature and moving through the world. But working with Kip at parts of the book, it's really, really important where he says things like, the tendex lines need to be going counterclockwise to the vortices that are going clockwise. You know, I mean, there's things that are very, very specific. And so that's been like a lovely challenge for me, just to, you know, kind of move into, you know, just thinking about representation in a different way. And again, I love that it's, you know, made me just think about my studio practice in a different way.
Mm. What a lovely note on which to open it up for. We can take, I think, just a couple of questions, and we have our helper here. Here we have an icebreaker with a question. I'm not gonna out.
Hi, Leah.
Hi.
I'm really interested in why you actually decided to learn to fly, because I know you could have just put cameras on someone's plane. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit how learning about what I'm a pilot as well, is like the magic of flying influenced your art?
Yes, that's a great question. I don't think I would ever make anything where I was having someone do the performance, because as a pilot, you know, when you learn to fly, it sounds really cool, but you're essentially like a puppy that's tied to like the leg of a chair. Like, the puppy cannot go wander around your living room. It's like, you can only stay here. And I love that the video actually represents my own physical limitations of where my instructor would let me go. In terms of like learning, and I think that when I started learning how to fly, my intention wasn't to do it to make an art project. It was something that I had just always wanted to do. My father was a pilot, and I had just, you know, been in awe of flying, you know, kind of my whole life. And I think once I started doing it, I realized like this is such an incredible opportunity to create, to try to replicate this experience and share it in a different way. So it's almost like the experience and awe of flying itself created the interest to make the art piece. Yeah.
You take your pick. There's somebody very excited back there.
Yeah, since astronomy is such a common theme and inspiration for you, I'm very curious to hear about what is the first emotion you felt when you saw the James Webb like telescope images that came out, and what was, in a way, did it change or inspire you in any way going forward?
Let's both answer that. I mean, it's just completely awe-inspiring. You know, I think it, with the just, you know, I probably felt the same thing that I felt about LIGO, just this like unbelievable experience of like we get to witness this, or just being alive to witness these kinds of things. I was in college when they were building the Cassini spacecraft at NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, and I mean, this is 20 years ago, and just think of how those images of Saturn completely made us rethink, you know, just by looking at these rings. So I think there's something about the visualization of things that really will inspire and excite people for a long time.
First I'll say I have a personal bias because one of my closest friends who's sitting right here in the front, Natalie Battaglia, works on this stuff and has been working on the telescope, and she works on exoplanets and the search for other worlds. So to me, that's really the most exciting. It's the least picturesque from what we've seen, but in terms of big picture stuff, this is really one of the most thrilling possible things for a human being on this world to ever wonder about. Yeah. Beyond that, I will just say that I was infinitely delighted on Tuesday when, for a brief moment, NASA's servers crashed, the first images, the NASA / first images, and it just gave me such renewed hope in humanity that people were so excited, right? That in this moment, we're so caught up in our transient urgencies and divisiveness and things that, I mean, we'll be gone like this. You know, our children, grandchildren will be gone like this, and yet yours too. But in the midst of all of that, somehow we can pause and really get so excited en masse about something that happened in our lifetime. Yeah. I mean, this happened in our lifetime. And it's thrilling that people can still step out of the small locus of personal concern to really share that.
Yeah. It's funny, when the first detection of LIGO happened, it was on the cover of the New York Times 3 times in like 5 weeks. And I thought the same thing. I was like, oh my gosh, people really do care about being curious about things that are bigger than their own personal minutiae. And I think that is, you know, kind of one of the most exciting things. Again, like that open invitation. It's not just the images, but like, what will it do to open up our conversations about these things?
I will say also, as a non-American, non-citizen, which the last few years haven't given me much incentive to apply for citizenship, suddenly having the president of this country be on TV and announce this, yeah. I was like, oh, maybe I'm gonna stick around. There was a gentleman back there who was very eager to ask a question.
Well, I don't know if I was all that eager, but one of the facts about this operates on time and space. And there's an orientation in space, of course, the horizon itself, but there's no orientation for time. There doesn't seem to be a start and a stop, except that there's a credit sequence, but you sit there for 7 minutes, and you don't know if you've watched 1% of it or half of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, and in fact, you could have taken the credits out, and it could have been continuous. So what was your thinking about, you know, the orientation of time?
So I went round and round about this, about having it like a nonstop loop. because you really do end where you start in many ways. But I did want there to be a very loose progression where, you know, there's some sort of start of a journey. And then there's kind of this moment that I find to still be like very fracturing for me is the moment that you see the whole sprawl of Los Angeles and it looks like these mashing teeth. So it's like the kind of excitement about the journey sort of turns into this like dark realization of the urban sprawl. And then that there's some sort of redemption when you kind of see the island and the ocean. So in a way, the only like the arrow of time, if you will, is really about like that there is a loose sort of journey of how you would look at the video. On one hand, you know, you're taking off from a airport. Then there's moments that it's kaleidoscopic and it's very abstract and it breaks apart. And so it was more as the it was more like it didn't need to be in any specific order, but they need but the video I wanted it to contain these certain elements to it. Yes, I think it's a little over 8 minutes long. I think it's the title should be on the wall.
Yeah. You know, this is making me think of, because I had the same wonderment about how deliberate that must have been, mm-hmm. and how it's making me think of Borges's essay, 1940 essay, A New Refutation of Time, where he says, time is a river that sweeps me along, but I am the river. Time is a fire that consumes me, but I am the fire. Time is the substance I am made of. And what Double Horizon does is it puts you as the viewer in the position of time. That's, to me, the most compelling part of the experience.
Well, I feel like you have adequately dressed to see this video at the Exploratorium. I really, you know, blew it by just wearing normal clothes.
This is all thanks to our mutual friend who makes these Risen Division jumpsuits.
Yeah. Did it make you more excited to fly or less excited to fly in small planes?
Oh, I can't wait. Someone needs to let me. Now, I can't drive a car, so that might be a hazard. Thank you so much for joining us. And please, if you haven't yet, go and experience Double Horizon. And thank you, Lia, for making what you make.
And thank you, Maria. And thank you all for being here. And to the Exploratorium.